There's certain music or artists, musicians, anything in the entertainment world, I guess, that has the ability to put you into a state of tranquility, a state of peacefulness and being at bay. And I think with the state of the world today, there's too much stimulation going on. There's too much noise. There's too much just constant stimulation. And a lot of distractions that are going on all at once. And to me, tuning out of all of that kind of noise that is so accessible today is very important for your mental health. I don't really listen or cover any new artists just because, I mean, you can call me an old head, but I like the old stuff. The new stuff that I hear or come across, it doesn't really do much for me. I feel like I see a lot of this and a lot of that, and a lot of the entertainment world I see today is just, there doesn't seem to be much depth or substance to it. And I'm not going to spend the next 20 or so minutes talking shit about society and famous people because I do that enough on my own time. But what I will say is, when it comes down to states of tranquility and at peace from music, the one artist that does that for me every single time is Sade. From her voice, her distinct voice, her fashion sense, her cool style, and the ability to consistently make commercially successful music for more than 3 decades, all while simultaneously staying out of the limelight and staying out of the tabloids and rarely giving interviews and basically just living life the way she wants to live, makes her one of the most interesting, mysterious, successful, and extravagant artists in music history. Sade, shall we? Born Helen Folasade Adu, Sade was born in Nigeria in 1959. Her father was a Nigerian economics professor, and her mother was an English nurse. When she was 4 years old, her parents divorced, and she, her brother, and their mother moved to Essex, England. Although her birth name is Helen, neither her family or anyone in her community ever referred to her as such. Her parents called her Sade from a very early age, which is the shortened version of her middle name, which means crowned with wealth in the Yoruba language. I can't pronounce shit, look at me.
Or I could have been called Sade and I was called Sade. Sade, really. But in England, everybody goes Sade. In America, people tend to go Sade.
Her parents' divorce at such an early age may have been a contributing factor in her music that revolves around love and the struggles that come with it. In a 2010 interview, she stated, "My mother left my father because she found it impossible to live with him, although they loved each other very much. It was hard for my mother because he was the man of her life. On her wedding day, my father gave her a red rose, and when he died, she threw it in his grave. She'd kept it for 30 years. That was the moment I realized how deeply she cared for him." Much of Sade's discography deals with emotions such as love, heartbreak, introspection, romance, and self-empowerment, stemming from her personal experiences in which she turns into vivid imagery. Her parents' rocky relationship played a contributing factor into her approach with writing music. Sade was mainly raised by her English grandparents in a small village in East Essex. She grew up a tomboy who loved climbing trees and watching cowboy movies, characteristics that don't exactly align with her artistry. She said, "There were no girls of my age around, so I played with the boys on the fringe of my brother's circle. I didn't have a girlfriend till I was 9, but I had complete freedom, out on my bike from morning till night, helping my grandparents dig their garden. I was very independent. My mom gave me that freedom, though she didn't have much choice because she was working full time." Sade described herself as more of a countryside person rather than a city person. When she was 11, her mother moved them to Holland-on-Sea, a coastal town in Essex that she didn't like because it wasn't country enough. And doing this research on her childhood was interesting because reading about her love for growing up in a countryside atmosphere around less people, it seems to reflect her attitude towards fame. Being around less people growing up is how she preferred it. Kind of coincides with how she wanted to be out of the limelight, out of the spotlight. I just thought those things are obviously connected. And I think besides obviously her music, that's one of my favorite things, or probably my favorite thing about Sade, is because usually artists want to be the center of attention and look at me, look at me, look at me. And she's basically she is the exact opposite. Many hiatuses and rarely giving interviews and staying out of the spotlight. I appreciate that about artists. The Grammy winner might have been destined to become one of the best-selling artists in music history, but making music wasn't a first choice when it came to career paths. Obviously, I've stood in front of the mirror with a hairbrush, she said, just like anyone else, but that was the extent of it. However, she did enjoy listening to funk and soul and jazz, specifically artists like Aretha Franklin, Smokey Robinson, and Marvin Gaye. And as a teenager, she saw the Jackson 5 perform at the Rainbow Theater in London, where she was working as a barback. Regarding the experience, she stated, "I was more fascinated by the audience than by anything that was going on the stage. They'd attracted kids, mothers with children, old people, white, black. I was really moved. That's the audience I've always aimed for." Initially, Sade's passion was fashion design. I mean, it's pretty obvious she's got style for days. She moved to London right after high school to attend St. Martin's College of Art and Design. To support herself financially, she worked as a waitress and as a bicycle messenger, while she and her boyfriend at the time lived in a small squat in an abandoned fire station. Modeling was another side hustle of hers, which she ironically didn't enjoy. She once told a Toronto reporter, "I'm quite anti-fashion in a sense. I hate it when everyone starts wearing the same clothes simply because that's what's supposed to be in this year." Once she obtained her degree in fashion design, just like most recent college graduates, she wasn't exactly sure what to do. Along with another woman, Sade worked for a men's fashion design company in hopes to keep it in business, but ultimately failed. This is where destiny set in and her illustrious music career would soon begin. As Sade gave up modeling, left her earlier dreams of fashion design behind, her friend convinced her to audition for a local funk jazz band by the name of Pride. She agreed, thinking that singing would be a fun hobby. After her audition, the band initially rejected her, but they ended up calling her back to join because they couldn't find anyone else suitable to join.
The way I got into singing was by chance. You know, somebody asked me to if I could sing. A friend of mine had a group and that had two backing vocalists. One of the singers left and they had a concert coming up, and he asked me if I could sing, so I said, "Oh, I'll attempt to." And so I auditioned for the band. They initially turned me down and then came crawling back to me when they couldn't find anybody better. They came back, and so I humbly and modestly accepted that.
Pride never became a major label band, although they did attract a small, devoted following throughout London. Stage fright was a problem in the beginning of her career. "I used to get on stage with Pride, like, shaking. I was terrified, but I was determined to try my best. And I decided that if I was going to sing, I would sing the way I speak, because it's important to be yourself." Everything this woman says is elegant. She doesn't give that many interviews, but every time you look at the interviews and the amount of research I've done to write all this, everything she's quoted as saying is like really profound. Maybe I just have a crush on her, but everything she says is like very profound. She, along with her bandmates, toured the UK from 1981 until 1984. Eventually, she transitioned from being a backup singer to the lead singer. And the band's following started to grow rapidly when Sade teamed up with Pride saxophone player Stuart Matthewman to write their own songs and perform their side projects separately from the rest of the band. By doing so, Sade started to gain recognition and fans of her own.
I went for an audition for a band, and it was like a jazz funk band, like a seven-piece band, and Sade was one of the background singers. And I was playing sax with them and guitar. And then, you know, we just used to hang out, me and Sade, listen to music. She turned me on to so much music, and we just started writing our own songs. And then we ended up deciding that she could do a little set on her own, just like a four-piece band, and we opened up for the other band. But everyone who saw her was just like, wow.
And while gaining her recognition, especially after co-writing and performing the now classic Smooth Operator, everyone and their mother wanted to sign her to a label. The problem with that was, all these label execs wanted to sign Sade and not the rest of her band members. Now, 99% of human beings in this position would leave their homies in the dust and just kind of take the money and run, but Sade is very loyal to her bandmates. Adding to the elegance of Sade, she refused to sign to Epic Records without her three bandmates. It wasn't until 18 months later when Sade agreed to sign the dotted line on one condition. Epic Records also had to sign her three bandmates. Now with both parties coming to an agreement, Sade was now signed to a label with the saxophonist and guitarist Stuart Mathewman, keyboard player Andrew Hale, and bassist Paul Spencer Denman. She was loyal to the soil. An interesting to note is that the earnings from the recordings and live performances, it's always been an even four-way split. And I just thought that was an interesting note because most bands, or, you know, when there's a front person, you would assume that they would take more money or automatically get more money, but Sade as a band has always been an even four-way split, so another loyal thing in my opinion. Being described as a funk band playing free jazz, the four bandmates began to work under the name Sade and started working on their debut album, Diamond Life. It only took 6 weeks to complete, and production was handled by Robin Millar. When reflecting back on his experiences working with Sade, he said, "I've always thought there are certain voices that make people feel better. Bing Crosby, Frank Sinatra, Nat King Cole, and Ella Fitzgerald. And when I first heard Sade, I really felt she had it. She also had an amazing effect on people in the studio, both men and women. Her charisma and how she looked." Within the 6 weeks of production, the band recorded 15 tracks. However, Sade wanted to cut the album down to 9 tracks and what she believed in the most. The label wanted to send some tracks to the US for quote-unquote cool mixes, but Sade refused, stating that the album was exactly how she wanted it. From the jump, she has seemed to always have a clear vision of how she wants to do things and sticks to her guns while simultaneously being loyal to her bandmates. The album consisted of a combination of jazz, soul, and funk, with lyrics mainly focused on both positives and negatives of love. The world was now introduced to Sade and her distinct, deep, and unique voice. Her classics like Your Love is King and Smooth Operator were two of the four singles on the album that was released on July 16th, 1984.
I wasn't expecting such commercial success, and well, none of us were. We never planned that. Obviously, we wanted our music to reach as many people as possible, because that way you continue what you're doing. You don't have to do a day job. It's your life. The music is your life, and you can concentrate on it.
I would love to include little snippets of like Smooth Operator, other songs on these albums, but just to give you guys a clearer point of view if you've never heard of them. But I'll get hit with copyright so hard, but I highly recommend listening to this shit. I'll try my best to explain how I feel like they sound, the aesthetic that it makes me feel, but yeah, listen to it. The album went on to become multi-platinum in several countries, selling over 10 million copies worldwide. By 1985, she became an international star. To me, it's crazy to think that just a few years prior to all this happening, she was a struggling fashion designer who got initially rejected from an audition for a local funk band, living in a abandoned firehouse with her boyfriend at the time, really looking at music as something she might do as a hobby. A couple years later, she has now released an album with her band and is becoming a worldwide star. Never give up, kids. Robin Millar, the producer on her first two albums, noted that her sound was different from anything else at the time, and after Diamond Life was released, nobody wanted to buy another Tears for Fears album. And when you think of the mid-1980s music scene, you think of neon colors, synthesizers, big hair, and a bunch of instruments playing all at once. Sade stood out because, as a band, they were cool, smooth, quiet, and went with the less is more approach. The lyricism had meaning. There just wasn't a political or anti-establishment agenda shoved down your throat. The band was an actual band, each playing their own instruments how they should be played, not some intense synthwave sound that downplayed the vocals. Sade's sound has been described as cafe soul or lounge jazz, and that may seem like a basic description, but it makes perfect sense. You see a lot of these like AI generated 1980s aesthetic pictures and videos, like interior design kind of photos, and they look like what Sade sounds like, if that makes sense. I'll put some pictures up there. As the hype surrounding her debut album started to die down, Sade's second album, Promise, was released in late 1985.
But I miss you. I could see through all of your lies, but still I miss you.
The album title is derived from a letter from Sade's father where he refers to the promise of hope to recover from cancer. The album was yet again met with commercial success, largely due to the single Sweetest Taboo. Just like Diamond Life, Promise was recorded live and consisted of the same producers. It landed at number one on the US Billboard Top 200 and stayed there for 2 weeks. This launched the band on a world tour and won them a Grammy in 1986 for Best New Artist. Being on tour seemed to be Sade's favorite thing about being an artist, rather than just creating songs. In an interview, she said, "If you just do TV or video, then you become a tool of the record industry. All you're doing is selling a product. It's when I get on stage with the band and we play that I know that people love the music. I can feel it. Sometimes I yearn to be on the road. The feeling overwhelms me." In 1988, Sade released her third album, Stronger Than Pride. I don't want to just keep covering each Sade album in chronological order and just kind of give some facts about it because that's boring, but this album, the third album, Stronger Than Pride, is by far my favorite Sade album, with songs like Keep Looking, Turn My Back on You, Paradise. Paradise is my favorite Sade song of all time, easily. But just the instruments, the bass, everything about it, the saxophone, it's very sexy and romantic and smooth, and it just sounds like such a different sound than what was going on at that time. Like I said earlier, a lot of synth was going on, and the Human League and Simple Minds and all these different bands, you know, Flock of Seagulls, all that stuff was going on, especially in, you know, England, where Sade and her band is from. And they were just doing this super different thing, but it was so smooth and it was authentic. You can hear it. Just like the others, Stronger Than Pride reached commercial success. And at this point, Sade had become a household name in the music industry. Consistently making good music and touring the world, but with all of this attention and fame, you would think that there would be this downfall or dramatic incident that took her out. A very common story in the entertainment business. But Sade was different. This fame and attention and success didn't affect her or lead her down a path of misery. She knew how to handle this lifestyle because, like I stated in the beginning, she was a down-to-earth person, a self-proclaimed country girl at heart. There, of course, were rumors regarding her personal life, like drug and alcohol abuse, divorce, and mental health, and so on. But she was extremely good at keeping her life private, and to journalists and critics, this automatically meant something was wrong.
Kind to you. There were reports when you had your breaks in between albums of Sade going off the deep end, emotional problems.
We all have our emotional problems in life, but I mean, I don't. Mine aren't extreme, and it's nothing I can't deal with. I live my life. I have a colorful life, and I don't really want people to know about my life.
But why do you think the reports were circulating? I mean, why would they want to go after you?
Because that they don't get you, and maybe they're suspicious. And if they don't have you at all, then you'll be invented completely. So.
That's the part of this business you despise.
You know, I don't necessarily believe you have to share intimate things with the world. I wouldn't get on a bus and tell a stranger, you know, personal things about me. And if I did, I would be telling one person. You know, that's what's strange about doing interviews is that I'm talking to you, Jill, but indirectly, you know, I'm talking to, you know, hundreds of thousands of people.
Millions.
Millions.
Don't want to.
She's quoted as saying, "It's terrible, this Fleet Street mentality that if something seems simple and easy, there must be something funny going on." What is known about her personal life is that, with her lyrics based around love and the hardships that come with it, these were experiences that she faced firsthand. Between her third and fourth album, she married Carlos Pliego, a Spanish film director. The marriage disintegrated in 1995. An old associate noted that Sade was no pushover when it came to relationships and she was always independent. When asked about the ending of her six-year marriage, she stated, "It was very sad. It was a very sad situation. I had to leave, very quickly, with a very small bag. It took 5 years for it not to be something that affected the way I felt. It wasn't like I was crawling out of bed every day or anything like that, but it would have really undermined love for me to get over it quickly. If you really love someone, that's the way it is." This is why she conveyed her spiritual and emotional feelings of love and heartbreak perfectly in her music, because these are things she was experiencing firsthand, and she wrote about what she felt and she wrote about what she experienced. Something that honestly people don't really do. They just make music for more of the entertainment, but I think the way she conveys it so perfectly through her lyrics and just the overall sound is because this is what she was going through in real time, and these are actual human emotions specific to her, and she figured out a way to convey them and portray them through music, and that's why I think it's you're able to tell that by listening to her music. You can tell, yeah, she's definitely feeling this, or she definitely has gone through something, or she definitely has experienced this firsthand, and she's putting it through music perfectly. She would only write music if it actually had something to do with her reality. I mean, this could possibly be why she is known for taking such long hiatuses from the spotlight. She said, "If there's something big going on in my life, I can't switch it off in the middle and go make a record. Luckily, because I'm in the position that I don't have to work, I can put the people in my life as a priority. A relative of mine got very sick and I was there looking after her with my mom. I couldn't walk away. You can talk about stuff and sing about stuff, but if you don't live it in the end, then it's all fake." By the time her fourth album, Love Deluxe, came out in 1992, Sade was extremely successful. Tracks like No Ordinary Love, Cherish the Day, and Kiss of Life reassured her fans that her consistency was unmatched. She's also a big influence on many random artists, and I say that because Kiss of Life was sampled by MF Doom on Operation Doomsday. Like, crazy when you think about it, an insane kind of, not collaboration, but a sample of MF Doom sampling Sade. Chino Moreno was quoted as saying Sade was a huge influence on him. And one thing I noticed on their debut album, White Pony, I think that's their debut album, they have a song called Teenager that came out in 2000. And Sade has a song on this album, Love Deluxe, that came out in 1992 called Mermaid. And if you listen to both those songs, the instrumentals in the beginning sound very similar. That's not anything that I found, like there's a correlation between the two, if Chino Moreno got influenced by that song specifically, but he is noted as saying that that album, Love Deluxe, is inspiring and Sade is inspiring, and I always thought those two songs sounded similar. Jesus Christ, I'm caffeinated, but you get the point. The single, No Ordinary Love, granted Sade another Grammy nomination. However, during this time period, Sade's first major hiatus took place. In 1996, during a time of more rumors and false reports about her health and substance abuse problems, she had a daughter named Isla with a Jamaican music producer named Bob Morgan. This was around the time that Sade's only real scandal ever occurred, when Jamaican authorities attempted to pull her over, in which she allegedly tried to speed off, cursed at the police officers, and resisted arrest. Her account differs, in which she states the Jamaican police wanted a bribe that she would not accept. As the new millennium approached, Sade hadn't released an album in almost 8 years. In 2000, the band made a long-awaited comeback and released Lovers Rock. Sonically, the album sounded different than previous projects from Sade, with a more reggae, soft rock sound.
When I was younger, I'd listened to Lovers Rock music, which is a sort of soft, sweet kind of reggae. Oftentimes, he'll put a little reggae beat in, just the guitar, and I'll sing along kind of Lovers Rock styly. When I hear a beat like that, I feel lifted up and inspired. And also, because I'm not a Lovers Rock singer, I can sort of go somewhere else, I can go and become someone for a few minutes that I'm not, and sing in a way that I wouldn't necessarily naturally sing.
And I believe that there was no saxophone at all used in that entire album, which is completely different compared to previous Sade albums, because that was like one of the main instruments and vibes. The lyrics, however, still touched on both positives and negatives of love, romance, and heartbreak. An 8-year hiatus would usually steer fans away from most bands and most artists, but that didn't occur with this band. Andrew Hale, the band's keyboardist, told a reporter, "It's strange because most bands are forgotten about when there's a long hiatus between albums, but with us it seems like the opposite, particularly in the last few years. I think a whole new generation has responded not only to the music, but also Sade's reserve and the wish to only say something when the time is right. In the silence, the influence has grown. Together, our audience, time has passed, lives have been lived, but essentially, when it comes to making music, nothing has changed. Still wanting to write a better song, still easy in each other's company, still laughing at the same jokes. To be relevant not only to the audience that has grown with us, but also a younger generation, is hugely rewarding and not something we take for granted." I mean, when you think about it, this band, since 1983, has had the same four members. No one has ever changed or left. I'm trying to think if any other band has ever done that. I don't know. What I keep finding with Sade and her creative process, along with the rest of the band, is that she would only write music when she felt the time was right, where her words and creativity held substance and meaning. A big reason musical artists fall off the face of the earth is because they get a taste for success when they're hungry and creative, but that creativity ends up diminishing because an artist just wants to pump out music and lyrics like they have to meet a quota. These hiatuses with Sade obviously have worked. It must have been some spiritual thing her music gives off because it keeps listeners waiting, even if it's 8 years in between albums. In her words, I just feel like for me as a person, it's essential to be a part of the world, to actually be with family and friends, not to be removed from the essential stuff of life. I think you should make an album only when you've got something to say. I don't have to make an album every year to stay in the limelight or to fulfill other people's expectations of me. Lovers Rock gained the band yet another Grammy nomination in 2002 for Best Pop Vocal Album. The band toured the album in 2001 with Sade bringing her daughter on tour but stating that she would put her to bed before going on stage and that she didn't want her daughter to see all the people screaming her name, thinking it would be weird for her only child to witness. After the 2001 tour, the band went on to one more hiatus until 2010. Sade to me is like Grand Theft Auto. It takes years before another game drops, the hype is still there, and it still has people waiting patiently. In 2010, Sade released Soldier of Love, making the last album the band has ever released. It reached number one on the Billboard 200, the first time in 25 years since their second album, Promise. The band got together to record the album in 2008, which was the first time the four members were reunited since their 2001 Lovers Rock tour. The album, once again, was met with commercial success and positive reviews from the fans and critics. But since 2010, Sade herself has maintained a notorious low profile. She has mastered the art of staying out of the spotlight, rarely giving interviews, and not having any active social media accounts. Usually, artists and entertainers try to be mysterious, not because that's how they feel, but because being mysterious and wearing sunglasses inside while pretending not to be interested in interviews just looks cool. The difference between Sade and the rest of them is she's authentic. Her style, her personality, the music itself, it's all real. What you see is what you get. Her former boyfriend, Robert Elms, told a reporter, she never wanted to be famous. She just wanted to write and sing good songs. She always found celebrity life very vulgar. What is known is the 63-year-old, who is aged like fine wine, is living the quiet life with her partner Ian Watts, her goddaughter, her mother, and their dog Jesse James on her farm in West Country, England. In her last known interview in 2020, she stated she has songs she wants to write, but she's also rediscovered the joy that cooking brings her. When speaking about her current partner, Sade said, Ian was a Royal Marine, then a fireman, then a Cambridge graduate in chemistry. I always said that if I could just find a guy who could chop wood and have a nice smile, it didn't bother me if he was an aristocrat or a thug, as long as he was a good guy. I've ended up with an educated thug. See, just like that. The most prominent artist in regards to the genre of love and romance finally found the one, and she makes it sound like it's not that hard. You just gotta find one that can chop wood and can smile. I gotta learn how to chop wood. Sade has been spotted numerous times throughout recent years driving her Volvo into London, but she spends most of her time in the countryside with her family, living life exactly how she wants to. Apparently, in January 2023, Sade visited Brad Pitt's recording studio that he built in France, where he had the idea of creating a sanctuary for artists to come in and quote-unquote do their thing. Sade as a group also spoke to British GQ magazine in 2020, hinting that they've been recording material at Sade's home. It should be worth the wait. Overall, Sade embodies a rare combination of beauty and mystique, with a divine romantic energy that is nothing short of authentic. Her cool style, distinct voice, and ability to stay out of the spotlight for nearly 40 years goes to show how much of an enigma she really is. Not many artists can reach the same level of fame and financial stability as Sade while still being grounded to the earth. Many have tried to copy her, but no one can convey the same energy that she possesses. I mean, look, Sade is my favorite female artist of all time. Ain't no doubt about it. I see a lot of what's going on today with music, and I say this probably in every video, the current state of music sucks and the current entertainment stuff sucks, but it's just, to me, it just doesn't hold value, doesn't hold substance. There's stuff out there that's probably great, but no one is making, I guess, beautiful music like this with meaning and substance that actually makes you think and feel. I hear and scroll through current artists, maybe for some inspiration behind a video, but I can't get behind it. It's all really dark and narcissistic and doesn't really hold much value. And that's why I'm so attracted to Sade, not because she's just beautiful, but her music is just real and authentic. And like I've said many times in this video, she doesn't have to be in the public eye for attention. She makes music that she feels when the time is right to make, and then she goes off and does her thing and lives her life like a normal person. It's perfect. Sade, I know you're not watching this, but if you are, I would love to interview you. But that won't happen. My favorite female artist of all time, Sade. Hope you enjoyed.